Welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming. How's the volume? Can everybody hear me? Wonderful. I'd like to take just a minute or two to do a very short grounding exercise. So if you feel comfortable and would like to join me, I invite you to close your eyes and get comfortable. And start with a deep, relaxed breath. Feeling it go into the bottom of your belly. And coming into this relaxed state, become aware of the contact points between you and the earth. It may be your ankles, your sits bones, your hands, your back. And become aware of the space around you, of the sounds in this environment, of the people sitting between you. There is nothing to do. There is nowhere to go. There is no one to be. By taking one more deep, relaxing breath, I invite you to come back into the space and open your eyes with a soft gaze. Thank you. I really needed that. So I was recently at a conference in the Midwest where I got to see some phenomenal speakers talk about topics related to consciousness and evolution through the scope of their work of science and psychology and spirituality. And one of the final speakers, her name was Adele, and she gave a talk right after the director of brain research from Yale. And she spoke about her research into ceremony and how humans throughout history have participated in rites of passage, and that it's our shared history to take part in ritual. And then she started talking about Burning Man and about how festivals have become our modern ceremony that provide the rites of passages that function to mark our entry into adulthood and other developmental stages. And I nearly jumped out of my seat. I was so excited sitting between all of these white-haired, prominent researchers and spiritual leaders, hearing Adele speak my language, our language. We are social creatures, bundles of relations, and our self is emergent through contextual support. When we come together in this festival setting, we're reminded of the nourishment that we receive in the presence of community. And we come here to feel, to see and be seen, to release, to grieve, to rejoice, to grow. And it's not uncommon for attendees to change their everyday conscious awareness through dance, music, yoga, tantra, sleep deprivation, singing, and others with psychoactive substances. And I imagine most of us are sitting here today because we know what powerful tools psychedelics are. Sant Groff, one of the early pioneers of psychedelic research, said that they are non-specific amplifiers. They bring forth what is already there. And the term literally means mind manifesting. Stan says that LSD is to the mind what the microscope is to biology, and the telescope is to astronomy. by taking a psychedelic, we're inviting the opportunity to more clearly see our psychological processes. And it's the belief of many people who work with psychedelics therapeutically that they give us the opportunity to tap into our inner healer, and that we are always moving toward wholeness. But the thing is that wholeness is not always, it's never about only the light. It's about our shadow, our sadness, our grief, our fear, and other unconscious, repressed psychological material. So essentially, whatever has a strong enough emotional charge and is close enough to the surface may come up to be reprocessed during a psychological, during a psychedelic experience. And sometimes this can be ecstatic joy, and then everybody's happy. But other times, it's deep, deep sadness or grief. And it could be early childhood trauma. We all have it. Being born is traumatic. So, essentially, a psychedelic emergency and emergence can be said to be two sides of the same coin. And when someone looks like they are having an intense psychedelic crisis, what may actually be happening is an awakening, where their true self, their essence, may be coming forward. And it can be an incredible opportunity for healing. And this is an ancient tradition where humans have been alongside others going through transformative experiences, and they're in the presence of others to bear witness to the process. And when someone is held with enough support and is made to feel safe, then they can more easily move through the process and move into the difficult experience and integrate that part of their being into their fullness. And this reminds me of the meaning of the term compassion, which literally means suffering together, experiencing suffering in another person and allowing it to touch that place within yourself. And it is this empathy that heals. So it's important to go into a psychedelic experience prepared. But most of us probably know that even with the utmost preparation, it can still be a really challenging, horrifying time, unexpectedly. As Humphrey Ombudsman poignantly said, and he was the guy who first dosed Aldous Huxley with mescaline, and he also coined the term psychedelic, he said, to fathom hell or soar angelic, just take a pinch of psychedelic. And it's perfect, because we never know what it's gonna turn out to be, and it's really all about set and setting. What's going on up here, and our mindset, our emotion, our mood, our intention, and what our outward experience is with our setting, with the sights and sounds and smells, and most importantly, our social support that is nearby. So what we found is that by setting up a tranquil space at events, we're able to help individuals who are having a difficult experience, and we are able to help transform the experience with them sometimes. Into one that can offer a valuable learning opportunity and potentially even healing and growth. And so the Zendo Project started in 2012 with this mission, and since then we've trained about 500 volunteers and helped well over 1,000 guests. And it's our collective dream that, you know, psychedelic first aid will be an integral and required part of health and safety at events, so that attendees can go home following transformational experiences, not only in one piece, but also more grounded and integrated and engaged with their lives, their community, and with society. So I'm going to introduce two phenomenal ladies that I'm super excited to be working with this weekend. Erica Siegel's on my right, and Shannon Clare is on my left. And together we're gonna give you just a rundown of the principles of psychedelic first aid. And I definitely want to leave enough time for Q&A. And the Zendo will be open 24/7. We actually opened last night. And we are located right behind the Woogie stage. And we're between the Ranger HQ and Medical. And this public training will be followed by a volunteer-specific training for everyone who signed up to volunteer with the Zendo. And that'll take place. We're going to walk to the Zendo. And from 6 to 7, we'll go over other logistics. So if you're volunteering with us, make sure you come to the second portion. So Erica's going to kick it off next and talk about the first principle of psychedelic harm reduction. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. So the first principle of the Zendo Project and of psychedelic first aid is creating a safe space. It's incredibly important when people are processing really intense emotions and feelings that they have a calm environment and a safe space, hopefully with squishy pads to roll around on, but a safe space for them to kind of process what's going on in their mind and in their body. Ideally, the safe space would have low lighting and be insulated from sound. Hopefully it would have a lot of blankets and pillows and foam pads, along with as much privacy as we can possibly provide for the guests that come into our project, come into our space. In the evening, it's really important to make sure that people are warm. We have a space heater for tonight, which is really nice. And during the day, we have shade and fans and cold water. Fresh air is also really important. When somebody comes into our space, it's really important to ask them what would make them comfortable. Instead of just assuming what would make me comfortable, being able to really try to communicate with them to get their needs met as best as possible. Maybe getting them a glass of water or a cup of tea or a snack or a granola bar would also be really nice. It's also extremely important to have a calm presence with staff and all of the people who are working in the space. It's really important. I'll talk a little bit more about matching later, but it's really important to kind of match the energy of the guests that are coming into the space. It's also really important to try to be as calm, speak softly as much as possible as people are processing these. So Shannon's going to talk about the next principle, which is sitting, not guiding.
Yes, sitting, not guiding. Nobody likes to be told what to do. I bet you don't either. So we talk about this principle is that we be with somebody. And it can be powerful in and of itself just to sit with somebody and say, I'm here with you. So I want us to give it a try. Pick somebody that you can turn to next to you. It doesn't matter if you know them or not. It's going to be a brief exercise. And the person closest to this side, tell your partner, don't do it yet, I am here with you. So first, take a deep breath and actually get there with them. It's not just words, it is an action. When you feel that you are actually present with them as best you can be right now, tell them, I am here with you. And tell them again. And tell them again, this time slower. And then the person who was receiving that, just say a moment of how that was for you. Tell your partner. Awkward, great, no words, calming. Hey. So it can be powerful, yeah? Some of you feel the power of just those phrases. Even, and sometimes especially, when they come from a stranger. I am here with you all right now. We don't have to do a whole lot of anything to get grounded in this space and to have some companionship. So when somebody's having a really difficult time, to just know that there's somebody who is listening, who isn't making them feel badly for what they're doing or saying, who isn't making them change their experience, change their feelings, and who isn't getting sucked into perhaps anxiousness. That in itself is healing. You know, Linnea talked about setting. Setting is also the energy of the people around you. Anxiety feeds off of anxiety. That's what panic attacks are, as an example. It's anxiety on top of anxiety. Oh my gosh, I'm gonna have more anxiety. When is the next? Oh, here's some more anxiety. It just feeds upon itself. So when there's somebody who is not feeding anxiety in an anxious situation, that is the counterbalance. It's an anchor in reality. So when one of our volunteers, or even when you out in this festival community, out in your communities at home, are with anxiety, with a calm presence, that's the counterbalance. It is an anchor in reality. You can be a sober sidekick. Another way I like to picture it is it's like the bumpers in bumper bowling. You get to have your experience, but I'm going to be here kind of calm and protected so you don't go into the gutter. And you know from bowling, when you go into the gutter, it's like, shit. So we're there. We're the friend. You know, I'm not going to roll the ball for you. I'm not going to go up, run ahead, and throw the pins down. I'm just going to be the bumpers. I'm going to be here with you. There's a whole lot more that can be said about sitting, not guiding. I'm just going to say a couple more things. We could spend a whole talk just on that. The temptation when there is a challenging situation is to get caught up in the story. And while we do want to meet somebody's energy, for example, if somebody's feeling low, we don't want to, oh, come on, it's not so bad. We want to be there with them. But when somebody's feeling anxious, it is really healing to have that counterbalance, as I've been saying. And so it's tempting to want to do. What can I do? What can I do? Emergency. We look for what we can do. A lot of times with a psychological, and a lot of times the psychedelic experiences are mostly psychological, mostly purely psychological, there isn't an action to do. We get them checked out by medical if there's any question about physical safety, and usually medical says they are medically okay. They are just tripping, which, you know, helps us know, okay, we've crossed that off. And then it's just a matter of creating space. I don't have to put a Band-Aid on it. I don't have to give you surgery. I don't have to rush you to the hospital. And you can see all of those things as metaphors for, we quickly want to dispel negative energy in our culture. But the Zendo is about accepting negative energy, because as soon as you accept it, it's transformed. So that's the basic principle of sitting and not guiding.
Following up the metaphors, because, man, we could talk about a lot of them for this work. One of my good friends, Catherine McLean, who I had the opportunity to go to South Africa with last year to offer harm reduction at Africa Burn, which is the largest regional burn. While we were there, she's like, Linnea, we're like spiritual midwives. Like, there's not really a whole lot we can do, and we just kind of like sit there and wait out this birthing process. And it's so very true. And I think that's a good segue into the third principle that I'm going to talk about, which is talk through, not talk down. Sometimes when I'm out in public and I tell people what our work is that we do, they're like, oh, those are like trip tents, like where you talk people down from, you know, a hard trip. And so it gives me the opportunity to say, yeah, I don't know how you would talk someone down, but I'm pretty sure that anytime, you know, I've seen it
and people have tried to talk someone down, that's when a bad experience arises. Because when you try and resist what's coming up, that's when it's given more energy, and that's when it becomes a struggle. So we really, like Shannon said, encourage people to sit with the discomfort, to sit with all of the negative emotions that are coming up, because you know what? They're hardwired into us. We've evolved with these emotions. They're here for a purpose. They're here for our survival. And it can be an opportunity to sit with emotions that in our everyday life, we're not usually invited to experience, especially in community. I mean, we live in a society where we're all told we should take happy pills if we're being sad. And the Zendo is a place where you can feel like shit and nobody's gonna try and take that away from you. And it can be really, really transformative to be given that opportunity. So one mantra that I like to share with volunteers, and we always have a sign in the Zendo, it's really simple: trust, let go, be open. Trust in the unfolding experience, trust in the value of what is happening. Trust in the medicine, if that is what you believe you have taken. Some of these individuals will consider a classic psychedelic to be a sacrament. If that's the case, encourage them to trust in the innate wisdom of it. Let go into the experience and be open. Be open to whatever arises. Have a beginner's mind. And then also as sitters, it's a wonderful mantra. Trust in the person's process. Don't try and get ahead of it. Let go to the unfolding experience that's also happening within you. And be open to whatever comes up. I think one important thing is to be able to sit with the discomfort as a sitter, that there's really not a whole lot that we can do. This is a practice in not doing. And we can hold a safe space, and we can hold a calm presence, but other than that, it's really about time and letting the person have the experience that they're having. So breathing, focusing on the breath, inviting the person to breathe with you, and ensuring that their exhales might be perhaps twice as long as their inhales can be really helpful. And encouraging them to surrender into the experience. Oftentimes we find that, you know, the second someone is ready to just let go into whatever scary stuff is coming up, that's when it all just shifts and it gets easier in a sense. And as sitters, we really have no idea what's going on. I've worked with guests before where, you know, I thought they were just maybe having a really light, mellow experience, but they were probably more tired than anything, to find out the next day that it was truly one of the most difficult nights of their life, and that it was, you know, deeply healing to have someone there, or it was just a shitty night. That can also happen. And then I've also worked with people who, you know, they were thrashing for hours, and they come back the next day and they're like, wow, that was so much fun, thank you, I might do it again tonight. So just trust that whatever is going on, it could be really big for the person. They could be reprocessing something from earlier in their life when they did not have the support and the holding that they needed, and that you could be providing that for them, and it could be life-changing. So I'm going to hand it off to Shannon to go over the last principle.
Fourth and finally, difficult is not the same as bad. So as I said, as a culture, we're not so good at accepting negative feelings, things that we label as negative or bad. And so when we face difficulty or challenge, it all of a sudden becomes a bad experience, as in anything I don't want. You know, in that vein, a lot of things could be bad. We don't want a lot of things, but we have to learn as adults that sometimes challenges are necessary to get us to longer term goals. And so as a culture, we're becoming more informed about psychedelic challenges. You know, as adults, we learn how to brush our teeth, even though when we were 8 years old, we resisted it. We learn to exercise our bodies, keep them alive. And similarly, if we're going to use psychedelics as a culture, people are learning to not demonize any kind of negative thing that might come up and to work with that energy too. So difficult is not the same as bad. There's usually a turn in a trip when somebody has a challenge that is maybe overwhelming, not what they expected, came out of the blue. And at that point, they start to label the night as, they have some extreme thinking. It often happens. We do, people do. This is the worst sign of my life. I never wanted this to happen. I should have never taken this. I'm never gonna be the same again. Am I ever gonna get out of this? These extreme never evers. And then, as I said before, anxiety feeds anxiety, then that's just a spiral down. And that's why having good companions nearby that are calm and positive, whether they're in the Zendo or they're your friends, or they're just mental resources that you pull upon, you can kind of hear the affirmations get inserted into that negative thinking. And so as a Zendo sitter, we reframe sometimes phrases. This is the worst night of my life. I hate this. You're feeling really low right now. You really don't like what's happening right now. That's the reframe. Right now, this feels like the worst feeling you've ever had. Right now, you would give anything to be out on the dance floor with your friends. And yet, this is happening now, and we're paying attention to it. What we resist persists. So I had a friend describe it, another metaphor as these, it could be trauma, it could just be kind of negative emotions, whether it's grief, hatred, anger, guilt. And those emotions are coming out like a beach ball out of a pool. And if we try to push the beach ball down, what happens? Stuff over there, I wasn't expecting it. And we run over there and try to push it down over there, and then it pops up. So as Lene said, psychedelic mind manifesting, it's material coming out from the unconscious, and it's exactly that. It did not previously have awareness, and now we have taken a substance and have asked to have awareness of these things that have been hidden. I believe that taking a substance, even unknowingly, is asking, I want to see what is underneath. And then when what's underneath doesn't look so pretty, put it back. It's really important to have a space for that. So you can think about it in many ways. In the Zendo, we're, once that experience has become bad in a person's mind, we're working with them to do some reframing. Right now, this feels terrible. And also to give some hope, reminding somebody that they've ingested a substance that has a temporal effect and it will wear off is really helpful, because humans can deal with a lot of pain if they know it's going to end. And so helping people realize that. I mean, a lot of times people don't know what time is when they come to us, what year is it? But somewhere in their consciousness, they can get that. That gives hope. So when a guest can't have hope, a sitter holds hope for them. I know you feel like you're never going to get out of this, but I believe you're going to. I believe in you. I'm hopeful that you're going to feel a lot better when you wake up tomorrow morning. So injecting some positivity without negating the experience. Again, there's so much that could be said about this, and I want to be sure to address it as you, as community members, here at Lightning in a Bottle, at your homes, and also for those of you who are Zendo volunteers. You know, as a community, we can do this. When we see somebody acting strange, having a fight, instead of, ugh, what's that? That's the beach ball shutting down. just kind of an openness. I'm going to breathe some air where there isn't very much air. I'm just going to create some space here. And that's exactly what we do in the Zendo. So those are the four principles, and I like to summarize them by saying safely sitting through difficulty. Can you say it with me? Safely sitting through difficulty. Safe space, sitting not guiding, talking through not down. Difficult is not the same as bad. So those are the four principles. One of the things that comes up a lot when somebody is having a difficult psychedelic experience is trauma. As Lene said, we all have some kind of trauma. Some people have a more explicit event from their past that they're either aware of or not. Other people, it might be something more subtle, like just the way they were treated by their parents or peers over time. But that often comes up with guests in the Zendo. So trauma is, there's lots of different ways to look at it, but it's the body's reaction to a very, very stressful situation. So something stressful happens and our psyche doesn't know how to process it. We go into survival mode. So in survival mode, just like with the body, with your, if you're running a marathon or if you're in a country that doesn't have food, the body starts switching gears and it learns how to burn muscle to get energy. It does these things that are maladaptive over the long run, but they help a person survive in the short term. So when people develop traumatic stress or ways of their psyche working around trauma, they are protecting themselves. The problem is it's not sustainable over the long run. And so that event from the past keeps coming up. It's like the beach ball. Hey, remember me? You put me away because you needed to go to work. You needed to be a child. You needed to not hurt yourself. You needed to maintain a job and your relationship. But I'm still here. You can't forget about me. You can put me on the bookshelf for a while, but you can't forget. So what we see as trauma in the Zendo is that reminder. Hey, remember me, the trauma you never dealt with? I'm here.
I'm just going to share a short story. I worked with a young woman when I was in South Africa last year at Africa Burn, and her big group of friends brought her in, and it was a night of poly drug use, but primarily what I think was going on was a pretty intense peak with psilocybin. And she was having, you know, classic psilocybin difficult experience. And the interesting thing that was not common was she could not feel her left arm from the elbow down. And we worked together a lot, and I don't usually touch guests beyond just holding their hand, but I did offer some massage to her arm. And I worked with her, and you know, the psychedelic experience comes in waves, and it would get really, really tough, and then it would de-escalate. And she wound up having this really big emotional release. And at the tail end of it, she said, "Oh my God, I just thought about this thing that I never really remembered that it happened, but whenever I was 8 years old, I fell off of an ostrich, and I really hurt my arm." And then she had all the feeling come back to her arm. So it's just one example. We see things in the Zendo that are not rational or logical, but when trauma is in the body and it's released, it is often accompanied with a big cathartic experience, and it can be catalyzed with a psychedelic.
So, as Lene mentioned, massage, we do sometimes work with the body and trauma as therapists and also as sitters in the Zendo. And that can look many different ways. It can include touch with a guest's consent, but it can also be encouraging body awareness, such as just the simple exercise we did at the very beginning of breathing guided meditation. I said that trauma, when the traumatic event happens, our psyche bookshelves it so that it can get on with life in the moment. But that book doesn't disappear, it sits on the shelf. The body is like that bookshelf. Your body remembers. And there's lots of books written about somatic therapy, and Your Body Remembers is one. And so in the Zendo, we can work with the body. Simple questions. What do you notice in your body? Sometimes people aren't at the point where they're dialoguing, they're not verbal, they're not answering questions, especially can sometimes be difficult with somebody who's far into a psychedelic experience. And in that case, saying things like breathing, just saying the word breathing. And what happens? Breathing. Nobody's telling me to breathe. There's no I, there's no you, there's no question, there's no demand. We make invitations. I encourage you to focus on your heart space and notice what's there. I notice that your heart rate, that your chest is beating fast. Looks like you're breathing really hard. And that is an invitation. If somebody wants to put words on that, they can. If they want to pay attention to that, they can. And that helps the emotions come out. It helps us process the emotions. The body is like a container, a vessel. It's the hammer that can drive the nail. It's a way that we can actually let energy out. And it's very good at that. It's built for that. Not just physical energy, but emotional energy. And they could be one and the same. So we can encourage people to have their own awareness. I often like to encourage people, especially if they're working with grief or sadness, to put their hand on their heart and maybe to close their eyes and just feel, what does that feel like? What does your heart feel like? And the answers sometimes are shocking. I don't feel a heart. It's just hollow. I feel a little stone in there. It's tiny. It's really hard. Wow, I feel this enormous beating organism. It's breathing me. It's beautiful. You know, we open that door, and that person can take that invitation however they want. But it gives something, a medium for us to work on the emotions. So how are you feeling? It's like words. Put your hand on your heart. Notice what you feel there. Yeah.
This is a great segue into the next part, which Erica's gonna kick us off talking about techniques when you're sitting with someone. And Shannon, I'm really thankful that you brought up one of my favorites, which is instead of offering a directive, putting an ing behind it. So instead of, hey, breathe, breathe, breathing, relaxing, just breathing and breathing with that person at the same time.
Thanks. So one of the most, in my opinion, most important techniques is compassionate listening and really being able to listen to what the guests are saying to you and really being able to reflect back to them your interpretation about it. A lot of times people will say, you know, I feel like I'm dying, and you can say back to them, you know, I hear like you feel like you're going through a challenging experience, or I hear you feel like you're dying. Being able to reassure them is also really important. Sometimes people come in and they're really disoriented and really confused, and it might be a great time to kind of remind them you took a substance and it's working in your system, and as it runs its course, it will stop at some point. And so just reminding them that they took something and that they're under the influence and that they're going to kind of work through it and it will stop eventually. Be really attentive. Be present with, for the sitters who and the volunteers who are here, be present with the guest that you are with. You know, if you're sitting with somebody, your attention and your energy should be focused on that person and not maybe the other guests that are in the room. And so it's really important. Let them find the words themselves. And that's really important to allow them to have that kind of independent expression. Don't go in there and be like, are you sad? Are you hurt? Are you this? Are you that? Like, don't, you know, be really quiet and patient and work with them. Some other techniques, going for a walk sometimes is really nice. Sometimes people want to, if there are a lot of guests in the Zendo, sometimes people just feel like they need to get out of the space. It's okay for you to go and take them kind of a walk around that circle, the harm reduction circle that's there. Shannon talked a little bit about kind of expression through body and sound and art. If people are having a challenging experience but are lucid enough, we can give them art supplies or a paper and a pen, and they can journal their experience, and sometimes that's also really helpful to allow them to get it out on paper. Do you guys have anything to add? Other techniques? There's so many.
I'd like to ask the audience, I mean, we could take maybe just one or two. Does anyone have a technique that they have worked with that they find works really well? Why don't you come up?
Hello. I just find singing to people, you know, and make the song up. Doesn't have to be anything spectacular. You know, everything's okay, I love you, I love you. Everything's okay, and I love you, and I love you. And you'd be surprised at the reaction. It just kind of shifts the energy, helps people find that happy place again, helps them feel love again. And apart from that, maybe something like meditative, like there's a great book called The Power of Now, and it really helps remove like anxiety and things like that from your life by focusing on the moment and escaping your mind. And Eckhart Tolle, the writer, his voice is absolutely incredible. It's amazing, and if you put that on for somebody and they can just listen to that too, sometimes there is awareness there. No matter how crazy things look, there's awareness there, and they can hear those words. And they may be listening, you know, even though they might not seem like it. And those words can really help too. Like a good book like that, or a great e-book, or I really recommend listening to stuff like that. You know, because the words, the presence of the person really like touches the personality too. You can feel that personality. So, all right, thank you.
Sounds like we need a Zendo soundtrack.
Any other takers?
Hi everyone, my name is Katie. One of the things that I wanted to bring up in the practice of working with people is the importance of body language and how body language can kind of communicate what's going on more subtly with us. So if someone comes into the Zendo and they said, well, I just took 5 hits of acid and 7 grams of mushrooms, and your body language goes, oh, like that's gonna communicate a message to them. It's gonna communicate that your discomfort, and that's going to change their experience. So I think it's really important when people come into the Zendo to be able to have that unconditional human regard for them. And so if someone comes in and says that they've taken a lot of substance, to just be say, okay, and to have that compassion, not to let your judgment come up and affect their experience. Because people are smart, and they'll be able to read that, and they'll be able to see that. So just try to be aware.
Along that thread, so much of what we do in this work is help the person transform shame. I love the lullaby technique because, I mean, sometimes a person has regressed into a childlike state, and you may be archetypal mama or papa, and they may just be working through some shame that they're holding. You know, there's the primary, like, difficulty from the experience, and then there's this whole nother level enshrouded on top of it that is like, oh my God, and I'm having this too, and I'm bad for this, and I'm not good enough. So that, like, working with that piece, normalizing, this is when self-disclosure can be really key. I'm pretty okay with most guests being like, hey man, I've been there, that's why I care about this work. Like, there's nothing wrong, no shame. So many other people at this event have been there. Feel some solidarity in that. You know, this will change and it will pass, and then you'll feel lighter. So next, I would like to introduce three esteemed actors and an actress, and they're gonna do a little role play.
Hey everybody, thanks for coming. I'm Kansas, and I just want to thank you in advance for understanding that this is like a 2 or 3 minute skit that, you know, it's something that it might be over 3, 4, 5, 10 hours, so thank you in advance.
And it's completely improvisation.
It's totally improvisation.
All right.
So 7-3.
Yeah. Hi, Zendo.
Hey, guys. How's it going?
It's going okay. I found this guy. I found this guy on the dance floor, and he looked really like discombobulated and kind of like lost and fragile, and I thought maybe that you guys could help him out here.
Thanks so much for bringing him in. Do you want to come in? We've got a nice quiet place to sit down here.
I'm confused. Who are you people? This is just a safe space for you. Provided. And, it's just a nice, comfortable, beautiful space with shade and air and water and food and comfortable blankets. And I'm Kansas.
I'm Adam.
Hi. Hey. And I'm Ashley.
Hey. I feel like something's wrong. Like I'm not supposed to be here. I was with my friends and I lost them not too long ago, I think.
Yeah, your friends actually helped bring you here, and they said they'll be checking back with you. We spoke with them, and they're going to come back probably in a half hour. And just we invite you to just, if you'd like, if you feel comfortable, just hang out here for a little bit and be with us.
I feel like I need something. Something's wrong.
What is that feeling? What does it feel like?
I can't tell. Everything's all, I can't tell if I need to, like, pee or sneeze or eat something or drink something.
We can definitely, we've got some water here if you want to see if that helps. Just, you know, feel how that might be refreshing your mouth and rehydrating you. You know, it's, when you get out on the dance floor, you can get pretty dehydrated, so that might be making you feel a lot better.
So my friends know where I am?
Yeah. They brought you here, and we're just gonna hold space with you here as you take a little breath.
And just so you know, you're totally welcome to go. If you want to, you know, go find them, we're happy to do that with you, but we do invite you to just maybe hang out here for a few minutes and see how things go, and if that feels right for you.
Wow. It's a little less crazy in here, I guess I'll stay.
Nice, right?
But I don't feel like I can relax, like, at all. Still feels like something's wrong. Am I okay?
This is totally normal. This is totally normal. Your body is safe. We're here for you. Medical is close by.
How can you tell I'm okay?
Because you're breathing, you look fine. Do you want somebody to check you out for medical? We can do that if you'd like to do that.
Yeah, I will, because I really feel like something's wrong. And I thought when I put this shirt on, that nothing could possibly go wrong if I was wearing this shirt. And I think that's turning out to not be true.
Yeah, we medical's real close by, so we can make sure that that's all said. And it's a great idea.
Okay, we'll go to medical.
Are we still going?
Hi, I'm from medical.
Hey man, what's your name?
Adam, it's really nice to meet you. Do you mind if I take your pulse for a moment?
Please do, that's my name.
Great. Well, it seems like your pulse is actually totally normal, and you have really good color in your face right now. And I think maybe if Ashley in Kansas can just, you know, sit with you and take you through some deep breaths and help you calm down a little bit, that you're going to be totally fine.
Do you know what you might have taken and when and maybe how much?
I ate 2 hits of acid and then I smoked some pot.
When was that?
I can't read my watch.
Okay.
Do you remember kind of where did you eat the acid before lunch or after lunch?
After lunch.
Okay, cool. And how long ago did you smoke the weed?
Probably not like a little bit before I wound up here.
Okay. So it might have been about 2 hours right now. And these things, you know, can take several hours and you're doing fine. And we just invite you to be here and work through how you're feeling right now. Maybe we can, you know, we're breathing.
You could try taking a couple breaths and see if that makes you feel a little bit more grounded. When I'm there, keep your eyes open or closed and try either, and just really feel how the breath comes in through your nose and maybe feel cool. Feel it going down your throat into your lungs, and then feel that warm air coming out through your nose, coming back out. Do it. Let's do one more. Just breathing deeply in, feeling the chest rise and fall.
You're doing great.
Want to make out?
Let's just be here present right now and we can talk about that later.
This space is for you to just to be and relax, and there are certain boundaries, but we're happy to be with you here. Thank you for asking them.
It's worth a shot.
Yeah, just we can go back to your breath a little bit, and when you start to feel a little bit better, we can walk you back to your friends, and we'll walk with you and make sure that you're safe and in a place that you feel comfortable.
Is it okay if I lay down?
Absolutely, absolutely. That's a great idea. Yeah.
Good job, guys. Thanks.
Thank you so much. That was awesome. There were a lot of really like on-point things that were illustrated in that role play, and I want to invite anybody from the audience to, you know, name if you saw something that you thought was working really well, something, maybe a technique that we had talked about. Let us hear it.
Just honoring the client's knowledge of what makes them comfortable, really celebrating their choices with them. Like if they want to lay down, yeah, that's a great idea. Yeah, you want a little water? Yeah, good decision. Just really helping them trust their own inner process.
Other things you saw that worked well?
What I saw go really well with this presentation was
the two people's body language, how she was sitting towards him and how he was really, like, down, like, focusing, providing that space for them to feel like they're there with them.
I wasn't expecting you to go there, but when he asked to make out, Adam, and it was received by the two sitters, just like totally normal, like, no, but, you know, our space is for something, you know, for you to just be and be relaxed. In Kansas, you even said, no, but thank you. Like, awesome. When I first started doing this work and somebody, like, came on to me sexually, I definitely, like, I admit, I was like, oh my God, like, oh. Like, I had one of those moments, and it was such a big learning experience because, you know, it's of utmost importance to just normalize and make the person feel comfortable and to set that firm boundary. No, that is not what we're in here to do, and you're okay.
I also liked that the two sitters kept the friends in the story, because when people get dropped off at Zendo, it's usually they were with their friends and now they're not, and now they're with strangers. And so including the friends in the story, oh yeah, you know, you were, who were your friends? Did you trip with your friends? You were having fun with your friends? We can find them at some point. Now we want to keep you safe here. But it's not, you know, no friends, you can't have friends. It's you guys included the friends very well in the story, which was part of holding hope.
This is a good time to move on to the next portion, which Shannon is going to lead up and talk about ethics of sitting with someone in a psychedelic state.
Yeah. So there's lots of different levels of ethics. I kind of picture it on the intention level, what we're coming into the space with, and then how we translate that from our intention to our actions. Somebody mentioned body language. You know, that's a way that we translate what our message is to the guest. And so it takes a lot of self-awareness to be sitting with somebody through a difficult psychedelic experience, because they are hypersensitive and vulnerable. That means that a sitter needs to be even more aware of themselves and boundaries. It's kind of like holding boundaries for two people instead of just one. And humans have a hard enough time with just one. So self-awareness, recognizing that the person that we're sitting with is in a vulnerable state. They are highly impressionable, suggestible. So that's why it is so important about, you know, what language we use, how we say, how we use our body language. You know, and about sexual advances, finding graceful ways to deflect sexual advances, as you saw in the role model. I think that a lot of times, I'll just talk about it for a moment, some of the distress that people are having when they are having a difficult experience and being placed into the care of, you know, Zendo or somebody else, a professional, is some of it's sexual tension. I mean, how many of you feel sexually aroused when you're in that state? I mean, and so we need to find a way to, you know, normalize that. And the Zendo is not a place to have sexual actions because we need to keep the safety for other guests. But, you know, that could be, you know, I don't often talk about it with Zendo guests because they are highly suggestible, but in integration it could be, you know, Do you ever work with sexual energies? Like, how do you deal with your body's energy? Is a better way to say it. And so the ethics is, do not have sexual contact with guests. Not in the Zendo, not the next day, when they come back and say they felt a soul connection with you. Not ever. Because they're in a vulnerable state, and so what happens in that moment is specific to their vulnerability. There's a power dynamic there. So I talked about self-awareness, checking in with your intention. Why are you sitting with this person? Why are you volunteering? Why are you saying the things that you're saying? Are you trying to get them to lay down and breathe because you're uncomfortable, or because you want them to be comfortable?
And that's not bad. I mean, yeah, I want to be comfortable. When somebody's yelling and moving about in front of me, I'm not. It's a normal good thing, but when I'm taking actions and deciding what to say and how to interact, I need to check in about what my needs are and how I'm serving them and their needs. So part of the ethics is taking care of ourselves. You know, acknowledging when I need a break. I'm not gonna do anybody a service if I'm at hour 8 with a guest and I haven't eaten and I haven't had much sleep and I haven't had a break to use the restroom or water. We have a whole team of volunteers on at every shift for a reason. So we call it kicking it sideways. Take it to one of your peer sitters, go to your shift lead and say, I've just got to take a 5-minute break, or I'm done, I'm not being very useful right now, or I need some help. Ask questions. Ask questions of the guest. What do you think? How are you feeling? What do you think is best? How do you feel about having taken 10 hits of acid and then ketamine and then smoking some pot and then drinking a fifth? Non-judgmental is a big part of the ethics. That has to do with compassionate listening, as Erica was saying. You know, we of course have judgments. It doesn't mean don't have them. It means when you're speaking and interacting with the guests, don't speak from your place of judgment. Instead of sharing your opinion, ask for theirs. And if they don't have one, that's fine. The whole point is to honor their truth. Honor that a guest is an autonomous being. They are an autonomous person. And it's hard to remember that sometimes because people are coming in this altered state, sometimes regressed, sometimes nonverbal, sometimes acting what we call socially inappropriate in the festival. But they're still an autonomous person with their own rights, and we need to respect that even while they're acting differently than they normally might.
So I'm going to talk a bit about integration. The best case scenario when we're working with a guest is that at the end of their stay, you arrange a time to meet up with them the next day or a couple days later during the event, and you integrate the experience with them. And it's all about integration. We can have these huge transformative experiences, and then if you don't actually do something with them to bring them back into your life, they stay here at the festival. So meaning making is key. And some, you know, important parts of integration are just finding some quiet time to be just with yourself and with the experience, and also to move the energy in your body. And this is like an integration playground, because we can go and we can dance and we can do yoga and we can look at beautiful art, and we can also just be. Writing down, journaling, is also hugely beneficial. And I tell people that I work with that it may be in your best interest to hold off from sharing the experience with many people, because you may come away saying, I saw God, I know all the secrets of the universe. And your friends, they may just not want to hear that at all. So writing it down, keeping it close to your heart, and knowing that the experience will continue to unfold over days, even weeks and months and years. So our last section before Q&A is self-care.
So Shannon touched a little bit on a lot of self-care techniques that we ask our volunteers to kind of do, which is passing it sideways, which is if you are sitting with a guest and you are either exhausted or not connecting, it is absolutely, or if a guest is having an experience that is bringing up countertransference for you, if you feel like you are getting triggered. So for example, if a guest comes in and is sharing an experience about maybe the trauma of a sexual assault, and you yourself have been sexually assaulted and are feeling like you're getting triggered by that, it is
100% okay to go to your shift lead or go to one of the pilots and say, you want to know something? I don't feel like it's appropriate for me to sit with this guest. Is there another volunteer that's able to do this? We want to make sure that all of our volunteers are also feeling safe and allowing for their own process when doing this work. So showing up to shift well slept, well fed, with a full water bottle and an empty bladder are all really important things. But if you happen to come to your shift and you haven't eaten all day, or you know, just like really need just an extra 5 minutes to get yourself together so you can be present for the guests that will be coming in, like that's absolutely okay. We want to make sure that you're taking care of yourself. If you have been in a really challenging experience for a couple of hours and need to sub out with another sitter so you can get a break, or if you need to go to the bathroom, it's totally fine for you to get your needs met also. So it's really important to be able to express that to the other volunteers and to the Zendo staff about getting your needs met, and we're all open to being able to help support that.
I was just gonna add, if don't take it personally if somebody doesn't connect with you either, you know, it's okay. Maybe it's just somebody else at that time. So.
Thanks. Yeah, that's absolutely true. If somebody is like, I don't want to talk to you, or you don't really care about me, you know, like that type of energy coming at you, like it's okay to step away and allow them to kind of process alone but under observation, and give them the space that they need, and don't take it personally that, you know, maybe you're a bad sitter or you don't know what you're doing. And so it's really important to remember those things.
And just to, especially for our volunteers, to look out on the horizon, we've got lots of great ideas of how we're expanding Zendo, especially in the area of self-care for volunteers. And some of the ideas we've been toying with, and we'll tell you more when we know more concretely, are, for example, having meditation or movement sessions before or after shifts for volunteers. Having a volunteer debrief call after the event to debrief, or pairing up with another volunteer so you can kind of debrief about guests that you've seen in confidence.
The last thing I'll say on this topic of self-care is it's really simple, but it's really profound. Just remembering when you're sitting someone who's having some big experience that their experience is theirs and you are having your own, and just really like keeping in touch with what's going on in your body and knowing what is your experience and what their experience may be bringing up in you, but keeping that clarity. And so checking in with your body really regularly, grounding through breathing and scanning your body, that is really so crucial, because there can be energetically a real drain on someone who's a sitter. So we want to make sure that when we come away from sitting with someone that we can feel not depleted. So I think we are at a point where we can start taking questions, and I'll just close this segment by saying that, you know, in this work we stand on the shoulders of so many great leaders, and this work has been going on for a very long time. So there's great leaders in psychotherapy, medicine, advocacy, social justice, drug policy. And I've been told by a couple people recently that, you know, I think this, it's a great idea and it's, you know, it's good work that you're doing, but I think it's really ahead of its time. And I, you know, I took it to heart and I was like, I can see how you might think that, but I think the reframe that helps me in keeping to do this is that we are changing culture. And it's a pleasure to be working with Lightning in a Bottle, who is a forerunner of this movement for psychedelic first aid. And
I'm very honored to be working with all of the rangers and the medical staff and the security and the Plur Angels and all of the volunteers today. And Dance Safe, thank you. All right, we can take questions at this point, and we have about 15 minutes to do so.
What are the ethics around confidentiality in the Zendo?
Thanks. I skipped over that one. Very important. We keep guests' experience in confidence. So I'm a psychotherapist intern. We're all in the psychotherapy profession. As a professional, we have legal obligations because of our licenses and our degrees about keeping client information confidential. Zendo sitters do not have a legal obligation, although I'm sure one could be made, but we ask for an ethical commitment from our volunteers to keep a guest's experience in confidence, meaning that their story isn't the latest gossip to share, meaning that their identifying information is never shared unless it is to a Zendo staff who needs to know that information for their job. And, you know, it's kind of tempting in this work, because we deal with crisis, to kind of tell these stories as war stories. And I really encourage us, if we're going to change the culture, that, you know, difficult is not the same as bad, that we don't tell guest stories, or even our own, or even our friends, like they are war stories. But recognize that that could be you, that could be me, in that story too.
I also think it's really important to note that these boundaries of confidentiality, the Zendo is one large space, and you are sharing it with other guests and other staff members, and so there's no way to ensure actual confidentiality between a guest and a sitter, because you don't have a private room to do that in. I know at some events like Burning Man, we will have a private area for more challenging guests. But know that, you know, there's no guarantee you're at a festival, you're at a pop-up, you're inside of a pop-up, and you're, like, there are people walking by. And so there is no way to actually guarantee confidentiality in that space. But we do our best to maintain as much privacy as we possibly can for that.
Other questions? Come on up.
If they make it to the front, they may be on camera for reference. We should tell them.
And if you know you have a question, get ready to come on up here next.
All right, you kind of touched on this a little bit just a second ago, but I was curious about guests maybe that were a little bit more difficult and you didn't have room to take them more privately away. How would you go about dealing with that sort of a difficult situation?
So the model of the Green Dot Rangers at Burning Man is something that we've definitely adopted, both because it's good and because we've had to, because sometimes we get full. Working with someone out in the field, even though it's not a private space, can sometimes actually be the best case scenario, because we can keep them within their community, within the setting that they are used to. So we do a lot of work in the field. And sometimes it can actually be more detrimental to transport someone who's having a really, you know, peak experience. So we can go to them. And like Erica was saying, you know, whenever we have a case that's especially difficult, we try and have them in a private area.
What if they were in the center, in the Zendo Center, with other guests, and they were being kind of disruptive and negatively maybe influencing someone?
So it becomes a group field. It's like a community circular center. And I was actually told by a volunteer today that he was working with someone who wasn't having nearly as hard of a time as someone else, who was like, whoa. And this other guest was like, oh, well, I'm not at that point, so I must be okay. And there was this wonderful night at Africa Burn last year where there was this one chick who came in and was really having like a hard time, and it was transformed within a matter of 20 minutes. We were really full, and from that point on, she took this like blue glowing orb thing and she started walking around to other guests being like, "Oh, don't worry at all. In just a few minutes, you'll be good as gold." So it becomes a group experience.
Okay, so I noticed that you guys like using the term difficult experience as opposed to a bad trip. Is that like, I don't believe in a bad trip personally. What's your guys' like take on that? As in, is that something that happens, or is it just like a difficult experience that people are having and not necessarily like a bad time, it's a difficult time?
I've had a bad trip. Yeah. It's all a matter of subjective experience and semantics, but I think the reason that we make a point of difficult is not the same as bad is because we work with guests to reframe and to offer something that may be able to give them hope that this can change, and it may not be just a classic bad trip that there, boom, it's gonna stay that way, that there's an opportunity to get something out of it. But I've had a trip where it didn't get any better, so yeah.
Yeah, we all have different takes, and of course it is about semantics, so this might be pulling hairs here, but for me, bad trip is I did not get anything of value from this at all. And I don't believe in that also. I think even if I wished that night had never happened, I wish I'd never taken that substance, that did not do me good during the time. There's usually something weeks or months later, that was the book on the bookshelf telling me, open me up. And I don't like the way it told me, but it was valuable for me to know. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi there. So when there's a guest who's having an extremely disorienting experience and they want to leave the tent, like, whose judgment call is it to let them?
So we at the Zendo cannot hold somebody against their will. The only people who can really do that is medical, if they deem that the person is medically at risk to themselves or others. So people in the Zendo are free to go, although if somebody is having an extremely challenging experience, we usually will ask for assistance from medical, from the rangers, and from security to come in and assess the situation and assist with the guest. If it's ruled that the guest, if the best interest of the guest is for them not to leave the space, at that time, we will, security and medical will step in and hold them until they're at a place where we don't feel like they would be at risk to themselves or other festival participants.
Especially with LSD, I see that guests just have so much energy that sitting on a foam mattress inside of a pop-up, it's just not realistic. Like, they want to get out and they want to move. So we'll have one or two sitters become mobile sitters. And it's, we will just have them walk around with them. And moving that energy through the body can often be like what the person really needs, and knowing that they're safe and secure to transform the experience.
And that goes back to, what do you do when somebody's out in the festival having a difficult time? And there have been times where somebody's like rambunctious, like physically moving around, it's hard to even get close to them, and yet they're kind of distracting or alarming other festival attendees. And there have been times where a group of peaceful people just holds hands and gets in a wide circle and creates the bumpers to the bumper bowling. You can have your process, but we're gonna stand here to protect other people so that it's safe. That's, safety is our number one thing, and it's what the festival cares about the most. The safety of the whole and the safety of the individual. And we try to mitigate the safety of the individual so that it doesn't come in conflict with the whole festival.
Hi there. It's kind of touched upon it, but for people who are having a difficult experience and get agitated, you know, physically with us, what happens then, or what's the protocol?
This is a topic that we cover after this in the volunteer specific part, but the question was, what happens when someone gets agitated and potentially violent? We always tell volunteers, take care of yourself, get out of the way of violence. We do not do any kind of restraints. We have a lot of soft, cushy things in the space for a reason. And you know, if someone gets violent, we often get the help of a medical person. But we don't do any restraints, and we just ask that, you know, guests, that sitters and volunteers really protect themselves in whatever way is necessary. Now, I have been working at Boom Festival before where we use this technique that, you know what, it really works. And it's not something that I would ever actually offer in a training and say, volunteers, you should do this. But it's called the struggle hug. And if somebody's just like really like, oh, you can see they're starting to get agitated, you smush them like an Oreo with two people. And there's something about that, like having just that compression, that it releases oxytocin. It's relaxing. I've seen a guy, like, we struggle hugged him to the ground, and then he just fell and he relaxed and forgot it was okay. I think he just needed a hug.
Two people or two pillows. Oh, I just lost it. Hold on. Oh, I was gonna say boundaries for a sitter when somebody's becoming agitated, when you're feeling unsafe, to state boundaries while also validating their experience. I know you're angry. You cannot hit me. I know you're angry. Let's find a way to channel your anger. We cannot yell in here right now because there are so many other people. And then you go into, what can we do? Instead of just, you can't do this, find something that you can say yes to.
When I was a little kid and I had temper tantrums, my mom would give me a pillow and say, hit this. So we can do that too. But like you said, putting up that very firm boundary from the start. I think that's a wrap. Thank you, everyone. Have a great LIB.